Perhaps you, like Peter, have encountered failure and you're having a real hard time overcoming it. When Jesus needed Peter the most, we see that he denied Jesus three times in John chapter 18, verse 15 to 18 and 25 through 27. Like Peter, you have a choice. You can continue to live a defeated life and just dwell upon your failures, or you can overcome those failures and allow them to be committed totally to Christ. Let's go to him in prayer. Father God, I thank you for Jesus. Yes, Jesus, who became the homeless one and dwelt in our midst and showed us how to encounter failure and overcome it, be more than conquerors through you. I ask you to pour your Holy Spirit down upon us as we worship, Lord, that we will indeed learn that we can overcome these failures through your grace and by your power. In Jesus' name we ask this. Amen. Yes, Peter had denied Jesus three times. And in John 21, 15 and 19, we see Jesus helping Peter overcome these failures by three times asking him, Peter, do you love me? Peter'd say, yes. He says, Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, you know I love you. And then finally the third time, Peter, do you really love me? Then he said, feed my sheep. He said, feed my sheep. Face your failures, overcome those failures, and then experience the forgiveness that I want to offer you is what Jesus is saying to each and every one of us. Yes, Jesus, the homeless one, referred to as being homeless because he said foxes have holes and birds have nests, but he, the Son of Man, had nowhere to lay his head, shows us that we don't have to feel like we're just total hopeless failures, whether it's encountering homelessness, personal financial disaster, or other needs, but that we can be more than conquerors, as Paul refers to it as, through Christ Jesus who strengthens us. Robert Sims pointed out that every failure is an experience and response in which someone can gain wisdom or become defeated. Every failure is an opportunity to accumulate the information that will either redirect our life or steal its momentum. Every life contains failure. Some have multitude failures. A person's failure constitutes as a proving ground or can be a landfill for a wasted life. The difference is made by the determination not to give in to the plot of the adversary, Satan, to weave a pattern of defeat and despair into a life until everything seems so bleak that a person just gives up trying to live for Christ. Yes, Paul said, we're more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. There's so many examples throughout history of individuals that encountered failure and overcame it. In 1854, Ulysses S. Grant found himself literally homeless on the West Coast after he'd kind of drummed out of the army, so to speak, because of a drinking problem that he had. Well, he finally made it home through the generosity of friends, and in 1859, was so poor that he couldn't even travel from one end of St. Louis to another to be with his wife and children, so he ended up staying with the person he was working with. It ultimately forced him into the army, and you know the rest of the story. He went on to become one of the greatest generals in United States history, a two-term president. And it seemed like Ulysses and his family would live happily ever after. But no, he had a soft part in his heart that he just was so gullible that business ventures often failed on him. And one of the biggest, most miserable failures was one done by a man by the name of Fernando Ward toward the end of Ulysses' life. And he just really trusted the man. And the man took not only Ulysses, but his sons and his family, everything he had. And then he started to develop a throat cancer. He could have just given up at that point, but by the urging of Mark Twain, he went on and wrote his life memoirs and became a great historical body of information that otherwise would not have been written. You and I can face our failures, but instead of just being immersed in them to the point that we totally give up, we can look to God. And in the scriptures, we find such a wonderful prescription for overcoming failure. For example, in Isaiah 43, verse 18 and 19, it tells us, it says, forget the former things and don't dwell on them. And God is saying this. He said, see, I'm doing a new thing. Now, it will spring up and you don't perceive it. I'm making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. Mark, the gospel writer, had experienced, real failure. He'd kind of left the missionary journey that he was on with Paul. And we see that in Acts chapter 13, verse 13. But we also see here that Paul didn't want to take him on the next missionary journey. And you see that in Acts chapter Acts chapter 15 here as it continues on. Sometime later, Paul said to Barnabas, let's go back and visit the believers in all the towns where we preach the word of the Lord and see how they're doing. Barnabas wanted to take John, also called Mark, with him. But Paul did not think it wise to take him because he deserted them in Pamphylia and had not continued with them in the work. It was a total failure. Paul didn't even want to take him anymore. Mark had failed. But in Mark's story, like so many others, he experienced the forgiveness of God, and he knew that failure was not final. Failure wasn't final at all. It wasn't final for Moses after he killed the Egyptian, trying to be delivered on his own and fleeing into the desert. He continued to surrender unto God, and when God spoke to him, he became a great and mighty leader. It was also true for David, who actually was an adulterer and a murderer, but he just cried out to God, and God heard him, and God answered his prayers, and God continued to work in his life in a very special way. In fact, much of that is outlined for us here in Psalm 51. I just take a minute to see, what do you do when you encounter failure? You know, you've really messed up. Nathan the prophet had showed him the sin that he had committed, and he just stood before it, and he was just devastated. And he cried out in Psalm 51, have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. Blot out my transgressions, wash away my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgression, and my sin is always before me. Against you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you're right in your verdict and justified when you judge. So he came, he confessed his sin, he just threw himself in the mercies of God. And God had mercy on him and lifted him back up. When Mark had failed on his missionary journey, Barnabas, which means encourager, took him on, and Barnabas continued on in the journey, and God worked through his life in a very special way. And then to the extent that later, some 10 years later, Paul said, and he said to send John, gave his greetings to John Mark, gave his greetings to Mark. So they were actually reunited. He overcame his failures. And you can overcome any failure that's lingering in your past, just like I can, knowing we're more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. Mark stands as a beacon of hope in the midst of condemnation, depression that failure brings. It clearly shows that God is a God of a second chance, and how he can even use our failures, and we can face those failures. We can overcome them as we surrender them to Jesus, asking for forgiveness. If Mark can fail Paul and face his failures and be restored in a position of trust as a co-minister, you and I can also. We can continue to overcome this previous failure. This is the message of the gospel, which is also known as the good news, to the extent that Mark could write the gospel of Mark and share that good news, because he knew that through faith in God, we can experience the grace of God to overcome our failures and receive his forgiveness and pick up and continue to move on like that. Now, maybe someone's failed you, and like Paul, you consider them a failure and unreliable. But what would have happened to Mark if Barnabas hadn't come into the rescue? Mark could have been so consumed by guilt and depression that he would just give up. Thank God that Jesus is the Barnabas in our life. He's the encourager in our life. And he comes to us and he says, I will never leave you, nor will I forsake you. Come unto me, all you who labor and all you that are overwhelmed and a heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Jesus not only gives us a second chance, but he can actually use our failures to prompt us to provide a second chance for others, that we forgive others as God has forgiven us. I've seen over and over again in my life that if it had not been for the lives of so many people that God has brought in at times that I felt like an utter failure, and I got that second chance, I just thank God. I've also seen it happen in the lives of hundreds of homeless people, hurting people, people whose lives were just in total shambles, that as they came into the presence of God, as they came into a caring community, as they experienced the love of God, God had just totally set them free. You know, a few years back, in the midst of experiencing a major failure in my life, I came across a book by Dr. David Ireland entitled, Why Drown When You Can Walk on Water? He stated, not only does God have a purpose in our lives, he also has his own timetable. In Philippi, Paul was delivered from prison almost immediately. In Ephesus, he spent 2 years in prison. When a crowd tried to seize Jesus, no one laid a hand on him because his time had not yet come. as we see in John chapter 7, verse 30. But and when he was given over to his greatest trial, it was because, as Jesus said to himself, my appointed time is near, Matthew 26, 18. So each area in our life, there is a season. And if we can just surrender to God in that season, whether it's a fall season, it seems like everything's falling off our tree of life, and instead of going back on and getting better, moving into a winter season, we need to know that spring is coming, that he's promised, I will never leave you nor forsake you. You know, as I realize this and experience this, that that not just some things, but all things work together for good to them who love God and are called according to his purpose, it gave me strength, you know, to continue on in spite of my failures. I knew that God's in control and had his own timetable. A case, it was what I consider to be a crime of injustice, of shutting down 1411 Locust Building on April the 2nd, 2017. But I know God's got his own timetable, and God is using this to help other churches to start opening their doors and have other people start getting involved in the midst of the hurting and homeless. And I know that in God's perfect timetable, we're going to see it reopen. But in the meantime, instead of fighting him, I need just to surrender to him. And instead of letting failure depress me, I can see it as this little grain of sand that it gets, that's like it's in the nucleus of the oyster. And the oyster protects itself from this irritating grain of sand by actually releasing a crystalline substance that surrounds the sand. And after the period of time, that grain of sand becomes a pearl. So these irritating things in my life, I've got to release God's crystallizing substance of his word and the power of his spirit just to kind of begin to coat it over, and he can actually create these pearls in my life. Paul refers to these pearls in Galatians 5, 22 and 23, these pearls of life, as the fruits of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. So he wants to develop those pearls in your life and my life. But, you know, if we don't see it that way, as we get older and we encounter disappointments and frustrations and things that appear like failures, we can become bitter rather than better. And that's not going to help us at all. So instead of becoming bitter, we need to have to understand that God is at work. We can surrender this thing to him. We can experience his peace that passes all understanding. We see a man by the name of D. Martin Lloyd-Jones in a book, Spiritual Depression, saying the main act in the matter of spiritual living is to know how to handle yourself. You have to take yourself in hand. You have to address yourself. You have to preach to yourself. And so he quotes this verse from Psalm 42:11, where he says, why are you downcast, O my soul? Why are you disturbed within me? So we have to learn to start to talk to ourselves at that particular time. We have to ask ourselves, why am I down? Why am I frustrated? Why am I upset? Why am I unhappy? You know, we have to ask ourselves these things, and then we got to turn on ourselves and say, hope thou in the Lord. So instead of muttering over the depression and the distress, we have to get back into the whole presence of God. Remember that God is there, he has everything under control, and that we can truly trust him at moments like this. We can overcome failure, for we're more than conquerors through Christ Jesus who strengthens us. Yes, we can go on and be victorious if we remember to continue to first of all, surrender this, what appears to failure, unto Christ. And then second, speak to ourselves and say, why am I downcast? This doesn't make sense for me to continue to just be immersed in all this depression. For truly, I believe that Christ is risen. I can get up. I can move forward. And this brings us into a third point. It has to do with all those crazy tapes of hopelessness and negativism that are going around and around in our lives. We have to just put up the shield of faith and resist all that, those crazy tapes going around and around. Put up the shield of faith. Resist the fiery darts of all those negative thoughts that continue to swirl through our mind. Put up the shield of faith. Resist the fiery darts of Satan as they come at us from every direction. Stop the crazy tapes going around and around. Put on the helmet of salvation, it says at the end of Ephesians chapter 6. Put on the helmet of salvation. Know who we are in Christ Jesus. Actually put on the breastplate of righteousness. If anyone be in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has passed away, the new has come. The belt of the gospel of peace. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me, he says. The belt of truth, that's actually the belt of truth. The shoes of the gospel of peace, which is the gospel. Taking up that sharp two-edged sword, which is the word of God. So we got to stop the crazy tape. So what do we do next? Well, we have to learn something from Elijah. On Mount Carmel, he just had this great big victory. And this leads us to our next point, our fourth point. And then he hears a big victory encountered, confronting the prophets of Baal, and lightning and fire from heaven falls and consumes Elijah's sacrifice. But then he hears that Jezebel's out to get him. He takes off running. And he's filled with fear. Why is this happening? Because he's tired out, burned out, worn out. And as we see what the angel does to Elijah, we see the same thing needs to take place in our life, that when we are hungry, angry, lonely, or tired, we've got to halt. Because if we keep acting out of that, it's so easy at that point for us to become defeated and broken and hopeless. And ask yourself, if you're feeling that way, and you're talking to yourself and say, why are you downcast and doesn't seem to change and the crazy tapes, you're probably very tired. I know that when I get tired, I say things I really don't mean. I let down my guard, and I've just got to halt. I got to get some rest. It's important that we can get some rest at that particular time. And we see this all outlined for us in 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 5 through 8, how God helped Elijah in the midst of his downtroddenness. He sent an angel to him, and he gave him some food and water and let him rest. And then from there, God went on and spoke to him. There's still a small voice, and allowed Elijah to proceed and fulfill the purpose that God had for him. God has a purpose for you yet. Your failure is not final. You can overcome that. And at this particular moment, if you're praying and you just don't seem to get an answer, realize that God's silence doesn't mean that he's totally denied you. God's delay is not God's denial. So know this. Get some good rest. Get into the Word of God. And just begin to actually have a determination that you're going to seek God's purpose for your life like Elijah did. If you're stumbling around without any kind of purpose in your life, you can open yourself up to depression, confusion, frustration. God has called you at this particular moment. You say, but I don't know what it is. Seek the Lord when may be found. He will speak to you. You know that this is His will. Continue to pray without ceasing and look to God, and He's just going to let that unfold in your life. And at that point, instead of giving Him your excuses, give Him your life and watch Him do exceedingly beyond what you can even ask or think. Well, that brings me to this point by Craig Ellison and his book, From Stress to Well-Being. He specifically states how important a positive relationship with God is, resulting in a sense of purpose that helps us to overcome a failure. Spiritual well-being is primarily, he says, the result of a positive relationship with God that grounds a person in the knowledge and experience of His love. And as a result of a satisfying personal relationship with God, a foundation of abiding acceptance, love, adequacy, respect, identity, security, and significance is established in one's well-being. As one's relationship with God deepens, a sense of vocation or calling also emerges. And this normally leads to a commitment that produces ultimate meaning in life. Commitment to God produces a sense of purpose that both permeates and transcends the mundane and temporal. I told you a little earlier how tough it was when they then they stopped us from doing the work of God at 1411 Locust. Wow, the temptation was there just to get really depressed. I mean, after all these years, like at that point, I think it was like 45 years, it was our 45th year, and I think, wow, this is how they're thankful that after all these years of service. I mean, so I had to put my mind totally upon the Lord. I had to thank God for the opportunities and just seek Him as to where we go from here, and praise God He was able to move our headquarters, 2428 Woodson Road in Overland. And I said, okay, but that's good for the administrative office. What about the homeless? The Lord spoke to our hearts. He said, well, if you find yourself homeless, be homeless with the homeless. So we started ministering out on the streets. Brother Ray and his team would go out daily. I'd go out at nights with them and during the day. And then once a week we'd gather, in this case, in front of City Hall in the mayor's window. And we found ourselves doing something that wasn't being done, and that was providing transportation assistance for the homeless in the form of all kinds of bus tickets and other assistance. We were able to do that. And suddenly, you know, I began to see God move in a special way, and purpose began to emerge. And then he started having me travel regularly to Springfield, 806 North Jefferson, Springfield, where we did have a day center in place, and ministered to those brothers and sisters homeless there. And then at both locations started saying, okay, well, instead of just trying to get them in shelter, and the best way to eliminate homelessness is to get them into apartments, and those that are stranded travelers back home. I'm telling you all this because I want you to see that a purpose began to emerge in my life, in the life of our staff, and it will also emerge in your life at this time. So instead of just dwelling on what might be considered a failure of the past, remember what we said before, Romans 8:28, that not just some things, but all things work together for good to them who love God and are called according to His purpose. So just surrender to the Lord right now at this particular time. Speak to yourself, why am I down and out like this? Why am I just meditating on all this bad stuff when I'm told to put my mind on the things that are above and not on the things that are on earth? And just to rejoice in the Lord always, as Paul says in Philippians chapter 4. And again, I say rejoice. And here he is in a praetorian jail cell, and he's saying rejoice, showing we can be victorious. Maybe all this is wearing you out. I'll get some rest, halt. And begin to dwell up in the presence of God and stop the crazy tapes that, okay, great, you had a wonderful past, but here you are getting older right now. And wow, maybe that was great in the past. God's all through with you. Just got to live out your life. No, come on, that's all a lie from the pits. Realize that He's not through with you yet, but this is the first day of the rest of your life. And if anyone be in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has passed away. The new has come. So let's dwell in that newness. Let's experience that newness. Let's discover the purpose that God has for us at this stage in our life. Such a sense of purpose draws us out of ourselves and our failures, and we're able to be awakened to the needs of others. There's a world out there, a world of hungry, starving people, not only physically, but mentally and spiritually. There's people filled with loneliness. As Mother Teresa said, the worst form of poverty is loneliness. There's people who need you right now. You are needed. Don't give up. Give it to God. It's no accident you tune in at this particular moment. He wanted you to hear these words. You are needed. And you can overcome this, what feels like a failure that's locking you in the past. As Isaiah, as we shared earlier, says, don't dwell on the former things, but realize that God has a new work for you right now. And maybe you've just come off just a mighty work of God. Well, let me tell you, after you've experienced a mighty work of God, it can be pretty depressing to move into the mundane, so to speak, of the routine after you've just seen such mighty victory that's happened to Elijah. But realize that God's not through with you yet. He's just preparing you for your next journey of faith. So surrender to Him at this particular moment. Stop the crazy tapes. Put up the shield of faith. Resist the fiery darts of the evil one. And believe the fact that this can be the first day of the rest of your life. As Matthew chapter 5 verse 14 says, you're the light of the world, so let your light so shine before men and women they may see your good works and glorify your Father who's in heaven. Jesus is that light in our lives. And the real meaning is that, you know, we need to just let our light shine. We got to be like the moon that reflects the radiance of the sun. We're kind of Jesus moons, okay? Here we are. He's the great light, and we're just going to reflect it, that they might see your good works and glorify our Father who's in heaven. And that's why we got to continue to keep moving forth by faith in spite of what may seem like failures in the past. In order to do this, we've got to learn to rejoice and remain optimistic, even when we face these negative circumstances. And as I said earlier, in Philippians chapter 4, verse 4 through 6, where Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always. And I'll say it again, rejoice. Rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, Let your requests be made known unto God. And then there's a promise after that. And the peace of God that passes all understanding shall be yours in Christ Jesus. So think about that which is good and true and pure and right and holy. He goes on and says that. Pick it up yourself. Read Philippians chapter 4, starting at verse 4. Such practical advice right now to help you to overcome this failure that you feel is just immobilizing you. And along with the feeling of failure comes fear. And fear will paralyze you. For once God plants a purpose in your heart, if you're paralyzed by fear, instead of experiencing victory, you're going to experience guilt. So rise above it at this particular time. Know that you're more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus who strengthens us. Now, it's hard to rejoice when every day the news is filled with distressing stories about the world's economic problems and earthquakes and famines and wars and rumors of war. It is true that Jesus Christ and in Him and through Him, we can become eternal optimistic individuals because we know that all these events are just a foreshadowing of the return of Jesus Christ. And He tells us that so explicitly in His Word. In fact, let me just review that for a moment here with you from Matthew chapter 24, verse 9 through 13. So you're not shocked as you keep hearing this one thing after another in the news. And what does He say? Then you'll be handed over to be persecuted and put to death, and you'll be hated by all nations because of me. So the neighbors may hate you because you're trying to do the work of Jesus in the neighborhood. Don't be surprised, He says. He says, at that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other, and many false prophets will appear and deceive many people, proclaiming, hey, you're supposed to be rich and prosperous, and then suddenly the bottom drops out. You know, He says, they're going to tell you anything because they want to tickle your ears. But He says, because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will go cold. Many people will just be totally indifferent, whether it's to the plight of the orphan, the poor, the fatherless, the widowed, the hurting, the homeless. The love of many is going to grow cold. But the one who stands firm to the end shall be saved. And there it is. Overcome failure, remain firm to the end, and shall be saved. And this gospel, the kingdom, will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. And that's what He's telling us at this particular moment. During this time of earthquakes and famines and wars and persecutions, many will become severely depressed and will fall away from the faith. They'll feel that God has failed them with one calamity after another. But Jesus told us that the love of many is going to grow cold. And as a result, donor fatigue is going to set in. Many are going to give up. Yet in the middle of this, a promise is given that those who stand firm to the end, the same shall be saved. And I want to encourage you to stand firm to the end. God's not through with you yet. Stop dwelling on the failures of the past. Look to Christ, the author and finisher of our faith. And at those moments in my life that I feel that my personal universe seems to be collapsing as the radiant sun offering hope for the future fades and darkness prevails, I must know that at just the right moment, Jesus is going to intervene and His power and His great glory will meet every need. And as I reflect on His faithful intervention in the past, I can see in the past, along with His promises of the future, depression leaves and faith appears, for Christ has promised that heaven and earth may pass away, but His word will never pass away, as He says in Mark chapter 13, 31. So you and I can remain steadfast, immovable, abounding in the work and the will of God, overcoming depression, knowing that failure is not final because Jesus Christ promised He'll never leave us nor forsake us. We're not alone. We can learn from those failures. And as we grow older, we don't have to become bitter, but with God's love working in our hearts, we can become better with each day. And we realize that our faithful service to the Lord is not a waste of time and energy, for God is faithful. And as a result, we can overcome all these feelings of failures by believing and receiving the word and promise of hope. And Lord, that's my prayer right now for my brother, for my sister, Lord God. Help them at this moment to overcome this failure and understand it's only a stepping stone into a deep, vital, powerful, victorious relationship that You have promised. We come to You now, Lord Jesus. Thank You that by Your grace, we can overcome all failure and remain steadfast to the end and experience the salvation to which promised. In the name of Jesus, we receive this. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask Him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.